Flying Nun second generation is growing in confidence.
If you're inspired to get up there and play music, you know, always get on stage and apologise, you know, like you're going to gain nothing from apologising from being there or saying sorry. Oh, sorry, this is our next song, you know. You're there and you've got to go for it. Sometimes you fall flat on your face and other times, you know, it really connects.
Led from the front by a guitar hero who doesn't shirk the limelight, Straightjacket Fits make an immediate impact with She Speeds.
You either feel it or you don't, you know, and it's always been the criteria, really, and if it's true to you, well, it's going to be true to other people, you know, not necessarily everyone, but we really meant it when we recorded it and performed it, and that's the quality that lasts, I think.
The Fits are growing in stature, but they're also learning that recognition in New Zealand only comes after overseas acclaim.
And it was only when we went overseas and, you know, we started getting good reviews and all those kind of, you know, your Melody Makers and NMEs and all that kind of stuff, that was when all the establishment back here turned around and said, oh, you know, they're really great, aren't they? We always knew that. And that was good, you know, it was a good kind of hollow victory, but a victory nevertheless.
Flying Nun is casting off its humble beginnings and starting to make an international impact. Its bands are now going where few New Zealand rock and rollers have gone before.
There was just this whole orgasm of joy about being involved in this thing. We felt like pioneers. We are conquering the world, you know, and it's fun. We've got to turn more people onto what makes us tick, you know, because people love it, it'll be good for them.
Bands like the Bats are off to see the world with very clear intentions.
We went straight to the UK, that's where we wanted to go. We didn't want to go to Australia because everyone knew how bad it was there and what an evil place it was because of what had happened to Toy Love. And so we gave it a huge wide berth. A lot of the bands that we played with that supported us, that were local bands, we'd just think, oh, they sound like that, or they sound like that, and you could tell that they were kind of modelling themselves perhaps on this band, and they had a definite idea of how you made it big. You did this, and then you did this, and then you did this, but we just sort of played the music, and it led us wherever it led us.
Chills are also becoming seasoned travellers, and the reception they're getting blows them away.
This stuff was being accepted overseas alongside of anything else, and this was proven by our first sojourn to England in 85, late 85. It was only 6 weeks, but we were meeting some of our idols and playing with some really great bands, and they weren't talking to us like a bunch of country hicks. They were excited by what we were up to and wanted to know more about what was happening in New Zealand.
Expectations are high. The Chills have a swag of great songs, but Phillipps depends on the band to help realise the sounds he can hear in his head.
Martin's songs, they're quite simple, but they come to you with a lot of sort of caverns and crevices that you have to either fill up or develop. I mean, as a songwriter, he tends to bring bits of, you know, little gems, if you like, to you and say, I've got this idea for the chorus, and it'll be like, nee, 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 you know, and that'd be all that you get, and you're like, so you have to sort of start working on it. And we would work every day for months. It's that kind of dedication to the music that I think most Chills members had. So it's really about sort of helping him develop these songs along the way.
But the thrill of overseas adventure is being lost, eaten away by the daily grind of touring and regular lineup changes.
Touring with a band very quickly loses its romance. Certainly, travelling in big areas like the States has a terrible toll on personal relationships. It's very hard for a band to stay together under that kind of intensity. And that took its toll on ourselves, the Chills, and I think all the bands who really got stuck into trying to conquer the world.
I think he probably could have done with one band for 10 years. That would have been quite a good thing. It could have been one of the greatest, you know, ensembles of its time.
Meanwhile, Straightjacket Fitz take Flying Nun into a new world, signing a long-term deal with a major American label.
They were a whole echelon beyond what Flying Nun had been previously in terms of ambition, I think, and sheer ability. I think if there ever was a band to cut through, it would have been the Fitz. And they got so close. And save your face or change your colour, and just love our fading colour, 'cause you'll
never know another who will give you ever. The Fitz have a sniff of international success on their own terms. But there's trouble brewing between the band's principal songwriters, the abrasive Carter and the more melodic Andrew Brough.
I've got no problems in admitting that the Straightjackets were probably at their strongest when Andrew was on board. I think in all classic rock partnerships or whatever, you know, there's always this sort of opposite things going on and people filling in the forms where they're, and ticking the boxes where the other person isn't. And, yeah, you know. It's kind of ironic because we did split for the Andrew did leave the band over the old hoary cliche musical differences, so we just couldn't exist with that tension anymore between us.
Band plays on, but their label wants them to be the next REM. Trying to succeed on that scale in a huge market so far from home is never going to be easy.
Everything's just so far away and it's so incredibly expensive to get there as well, and you pay this fortune to go over there and starve, and you know, the only way you can really make an impact in places like the Northern Hemisphere is by being there, and most bands just haven't got the resources behind them to actually do that. It didn't really matter how well you played or how much of an impression you made, because it was going to be 2 years before you were back. But, you know, at the same time, you know, if you're based in New York or you're based in London, well, I don't know if you'd make the music that you make coming from this place. And it is the music that you make coming from this place that gets you noticed over there in the first place.